You're listening to the Spark Radio Network, internet radio like you've never heard before. Innovation, creativity, and imagination are all said to begin with a spark. So fasten your seatbelt and take the ride of your life and listen for the spark.
You are listening to KLRN Radio, where liberty and reason still reign.
Most writers and radio show hosts know that to connect with your fans, you need to do more than just write books or record the latest podcasts. There are many different elements that go into forming an online platform, but there are also many hidden traps. To make matters worse, solid advice on how to survive the muddy waters is scarce. In the book Hidden Traps, I talk about some of the important issues of working with an online platform, highlighting traps that could put your physical or internet security at risk or be harmful to your reputation. Are your social media posts just links with a few disjointed words, making you look like someone who can't complete a sentence? Did your new website cost you more than you anticipated? Are you leaking your personal contact details across the web without even knowing it? Then you need Hidden Traps. Hidden Traps is now available in paperback and ebook from a variety of retailers, including Amazon, Barnes & Noble, and Kobo. Visit blackwolfpublications.com for more details.
If you're 85 or younger, would you like peace of mind and comfort for your family? We're Final Expense Direct with an urgent message for you. The average funeral today costs over $8,000, but the most you'll get from government benefits is $255. How will your family pay the difference? We can help. Our senior plans start as low as just a dollar a day and pay up to $30,000 for a funeral and other final expenses. Peace of mind is easy. There's no medical exam. You'll have lifetime coverage, and your plan can't be canceled as long as you pay your premiums. Call now for free information about our senior plans. Answer a few simple questions and receive approval right on the phone. Plus, call right now, and we'll give you a discount prescription card for free. Call 800-553-8687. That's 800-553-8687. Again, 800-553-8687.
KLRN Radio has advertising rates available. We have rates to fit almost any budget. Contact us at advertising@klrnradio.com.
Attention business owners and independent contractors. This is a money-saving message from Tax Mediation Services. If your business owes $20,000 or more in taxes, we can help you today, right now. Listen, dealing with the IRS is no picnic. It's an intimidating and extremely stressful process, and you don't want to go it alone. Our attorneys know every law, every tax break, and every possible opportunity to help you resolve and reduce your tax debt. And if you owe more than $20,000, you may be at the top of their hit list. So don't take your tax debt lightly, because it will not go away on its own. The IRS can seize your bank accounts, your home, and even shut down your business. Call our tax experts today at 1-800-783-0810 and let us deal with the IRS while you focus on your business. That's 1-800-783-0810. Again, that's 800-783-0810.
My son was in the Army back during Desert Storm, but even then he wanted an MBA. He looked at a dozen schools, but only one offered the online education and flexibility he needed while he was in a tent in Iraq, Grantham University. Turns out that Grantham's been delivering affordable, relevant college and advanced degrees for over 65 years. Heck, if they can deliver a quality education to a soldier in a tent overseas, think about the flexibility Grantham can offer you so you can earn your degree too. It doesn't matter how complicated or full your life is, if getting a degree is on your bucket list, you'll want to do what my son did. You'll want to call Grantham. Find out how easy it is to get started on your education so you can check that college degree off your bucket list. Call Grantham right now. 800-910-1370. That's 800-910-1370. Flexible, affordable, relevant. Call 800-910-1370.
Sometimes writers feel lost, unsure why a passage may not be working. takes another set of eyes to help us nurture our writing into full maturity. At Black Wolf Editorial Services, we strive to enable writers to develop and grow, offering manuscript critiques and line edits through a mentoring editorial style. We also offer assistance on generating a writer's bio for your websites. Black Wolf Editorial Services, nurturing your writing into maturity. For a full list of services, visit blackwolfeditorial.com.
It's Friday.
Oh, let me tell you something. I am so sick of Washington and all its works, all them politicians down there and them congressmen. I'll bet you won't find none of them congressmen signing down their electric blankets tonight. Which if they did, their secretaries would get up and go home.
We gotta do something.
Absolutely.
You know what we gotta do? Foga party.
Foga! Foga!
Foga!
Foga! Foga! Foga! Foga! Foga! Foga! Foga! Foga! Foga! Foga!
Click! Click! Boom! I'm coming down on the stereo. Hit me on the radio. Click! Click! Boom!
I want you to kill every golfer on the course.
Check me if I'm wrong, Sandy, but if I kill all the golfers, they're going to lock me up and throw away the key.
Guess what day it is? Guess what day it is? Huh?
Friday! Friday! Friday!
That's right, that's right, that's right. It is Friday night. I am Rick Robinson, back in the house, KLRNradio.com. I am one half of the crew, Mr. Rick Robinson. He's the other half, Mr. Dan Wright. Good evening, Dan. How are you, sir? Feels like it's been 20 years since we've talked.
I'm good. How's it doing, big radio star?
Bitter party
and
of one.
You get the call letters right.
Bitter party of one. Your table's waiting. Bitter party of one. No, I'm just playing. So for those of you who may not be aware, I actually did a three-day stint on a local radio station here, KOKC 1520 AM Talk Radio's New Generation. Got used to saying it, so figured I might as well throw it in there one last time. I was on there. Actually, I was only asked to do Wednesday and Thursday. They liked it so much, they asked us to come back Friday, and actually we got to test Finding Common Ground, which was awesome because even though it was unbranded, it was me and Dave doing what started this whole mess years ago, and I had people that have known us forever that were texting me about the fact that they had to pull over because they were crying because we were both on the radio. It was awesome. They're like, dude, I'm trying to listen, but I'm going to be late to work because I had to pull over because I can't believe you guys are actually on the radio. It's amazing. I'm like, I told you guys it was going to happen. Nobody believed me. Everybody thought I was crazy. And then Dave was like, you still haven't really proven that you're not crazy. I said, but I was still right, wasn't I? He was like, shut up.
No, I think it was, I got to listen a little one day, and you sounded great. And from what everybody said, you knocked it out of the park.
Well, I think I did okay. What I really like is the fact that we were still getting positive feedback even after the shows were over. There were a couple of days here and there where people were actually calling into the afternoon show, complimenting the programming director, who's actually part of the afternoon show, on having us on for the last 3 days. So for those of you who don't know, the morning group now has a new producer, Brad Reed. He's actually the guy that was producing for me for the last 3 days. And it was funny because we never met before Wednesday, but it was like we have become instant friends. I think it's because the funniest thing about today, because doing the show with Dave, we started podcasting. So Brad's been involved in radio for a while, but he left radio and started doing podcasting, and he still does some podcasting and also does some podcast production on the side. And the funny thing is, we were talking about it today. I was like, do you realize that at this point, there is, because there was no management or anybody else there. It was me, Dave, and Brad. Podcasters had taken over a terrestrial radio station. I was like, we should just never leave. Just be like, y'all can't come in anymore. Podcasters own the world. But yeah, I mean, it was amazing. I'm thankful for the opportunity. Whatever else happens, I got to live my dream for 3 days, and nobody can take that away.
No, they can't.
That's the most amazing part of it. And the fact that so many people that have never listened to any of the stuff that I've put on, even though they know I've been doing it for... That's the sad part. People that know that I've been doing this stuff for years have never listened to a podcast, and they're raving about what I've done on the radio for the last 3 days. I'm like, I do the same thing every night. Every night, and I couldn't get you to listen. But now it matters because it's on a radio station.
Right. I mean, I'm one. I've always been, for a long time, I mean, you know, I was a pretty serious radiophile. I mean, I listened to everything from Howard Stern and The Grease Man and Opie and Anthony all the way up through everything. I mean, if it was talk radio, I listened to it. I loved it. And then I started listening to podcasts, and I just kind of didn't listen to much radio anymore. And the reason is I just, there's so much out there, and it just surprises me that people that knew you were doing this are raving about you now that they've heard you on terrestrial radio and never listened to you. I find that kind of fascinating, because when podcasts really started blowing up, that started being all I listened to.
Well, the funniest thing is, you know, listening to some of the people that have called in to talk to the folks on the afternoon show, and they're talking about the difference in quality and how refreshing it is. Because, I mean, I didn't do this Rush Limbaugh style any of the days that I was there. I had different guests on with different viewpoints. I opened up the phone lines. I didn't cut anybody off. I basically said, this is what this is for. Because, I believe this is exactly what I said to them, especially at KOKC, because they are the number one local station in our area for political talk, because that's how plugged in that station is to the populace. And the people that you guys, that they're either angry at or they're happy about putting into office, are listening to that station. So this is their chance, no matter what it is. Call in, tell them what you're thinking, because they're listening. And that's all I did. We opened the phone lines, we had guests, and I let the guests say what they needed to say. You wouldn't believe the first time I had a guest in studio. It was one of the Libertarian candidates. And we did the first 15-minute segment, and we did the usual stuff, and then we came back from commercial break, and I said, you know what? This last segment is all you. You're about to be in a runoff. Tell them why they should vote for you. Make them believe you. His eyes got as big as saucers. Because he says, and after the interview, he's like, nobody's ever done that before. I was like, what are you talking about? He said, you just let me have the floor. Nobody's ever done that before. What the hell would I have a guest on for if I'm not going to let you talk?
Yeah, that's you and I, when we have guests, I mean, our the way we think about it, I mean, is the guest takes priority. I mean, that's why we're having them on. We want to know what they have to say. We want to know what, you know, I mean, even if it's just a phone-in guest, that's just the way I think it should be.
And that's exactly why, how I tried to run it. And I honestly, I think that's why the local market here liked it so much, because there wasn't a bunch of screaming and yelling. There wasn't a bunch of cutting people off. It was, call in, give your opinion. If I don't agree with you, I'm going to tell you at the end of the call, thank you for giving your opinion. And that's exactly what I did today, because we had people calling in from all spectrums, because Dave was on the air and so was I. So we had people that were calling in that were agreeing with Dave. We had people that were calling in that were agreeing with me. And we had people calling in saying that we were both crazy. And I basically, at the end of every call, I would say, look, that's what this is for. I'm not going to cut you off. I'm not going to yell over you. I want you to give your opinion. Because your opinion is your opinion, and you're entitled to it. And everybody should at least get to hear what it is that you have to say. Because whatever your beliefs are, they're either going to survive or they're going to die when they hit the light of day. And that's what we've been doing in this country everywhere for far too long, is silencing everybody that we disagree with. I don't care what they're saying or how loudly they're saying it. That's why everybody's getting upset, and honestly, it bugged me for a little bit at first, too, with all this, you know, these people shrieking about normalizing pedophilia. Let them shriek. We need to see what it is that they're trying to do, because if we call them out on it and we beat them to death over it, they're just going to take it back underground again. At least while they're brave enough to shriek about it, we can see exactly what they're trying to do. Now we've got people from TED Talks trying to bring that crap into the light of day. I say let them, because that's the only way that we're going to be able to face it. And that's one of the realizations that I came to when I realized that for at least a couple of days I was going to have access to a platform that would actually allow me to connect to so many more people. Because like I said, people that I've known for years that know I do this stuff never bothered to listen until I said, hey, I'm going to be on a local radio station. You guys should tune in and check it out. And they did. And they loved it. And I guarantee you half of them are not listening right now, because they only care about radio.
Regular radio. They only care about terrestrial radio, not this internet podcasting stuff.
Well, I mean, part of it's ease of access, though, too. I mean, when you're just already in your car and you can just turn it on, that's one of the reasons why podcasting has actually started taking off so much more, because in the newer cars, you don't have to just turn on the radio. That's honestly why I said it just a few minutes ago. Three podcasters took over the entire radio station for 3 hours with management approval. That's the scariest part. They let podcasters in. They used to run us off with torches.
Yeah,
aren't real radio people. Get the hell out of here.
But you're totally correct. I mean, in new cars, I mean, I don't, my truck isn't even Bluetooth enabled, but at least I have an auxiliary input on my stereo. I plug my phone in and pull up the podcast I want to listen to, and I listen to it on my way into work. You know, it's, and to be honest with you, I mean, everything's a podcast now. I mean, the shows you did are on iHeartRadio. The radio show I listen to normally, if I listen to radio here, it's on iHeartRadio. So if I miss it and I know they did something I want to hear, I can always go back and listen to it, because it's in podcast form.
Yeah, I honestly, because I know they're still recording it, but since they don't really have a full-time host over there, they haven't been dropping the podcast. I really want some of the audio today, because I realize this is going to make me a nerd, but for those of you in Oklahoma, you're probably about to recognize the name I'm about to drop. Andrew Spino, who's with Right on Crime, actually spent 20 years in broadcasting and was a reporter for, I believe it was KOCO back in the day. I remember seeing him on TV, but I'm pretty sure that was the channel. But I've always kind of been a fan of his, because, you know, I've always had this crazy idea about broadcasting, and one day I was going to figure out how to do it. And I told him that the other day, and it was funny because he's like, oh, so you're the one fan I've had this entire time. I said, I guarantee you've got more than one. But anyway, he actually, while we were in an interview today, as he was on his way out of the interview, he said, management, if you're listening, this man deserves to be hired. And I'm like, what? I'm just like, okay, wait, Mac, are you listening? Of course, Mac wasn't listening. Grr. But anyway, it's just funny to think about, you know, somebody that's had that type of experience who has honestly been talking me up behind the scenes for the last 3 days. And I didn't even know about it until he told me. The other day when Mac was actually in, and I thought he was going to come hang out with us, but I guess he realized that Brad and I had everything under control, so he went to his office. Well, Andrew wound up going into his office a bit while I was interviewing Kathy Costello. And then on the way out, or I guess it was after the show was over, I get this text, because I told him that I was trying to see if he wanted to come on to talk about his criminal justice reform project that he was part of, and he never got my Facebook message. So he gives me his phone number, and he's like, shoot me a text anytime. So I'm like, okay, cool. So here's my number. And so I get to work, and I get this text, and he's like, gotta tell you, I'm pretty sure you're the front runner. I've been here talking you up the whole time I was with Mac. And I'm like, I don't even know what their plan is, but the fact that you just said that makes me feel amazing.
Yeah, I've just been, I mean, you know, obviously you've been extremely busy, but I know you've kind of you know, we've texted back and forth and stuff, and you've just been so excited, and I've just loved it for you, man.
Yeah, the one thing I kept forgetting to do, I kept wanting to talk to Brad about snapping some shots while I was actually in the studio, and I kept forgetting, and I'm like, damn it, I don't have any pictures of me actually doing my thing in an actual studio. I did, however, take a picture of Dave in the studio today, so there's at least proof that he was there.
So there's proof that Dave was there, no proof that you were there. Dave could use this.
You guys heard me, so shut up. You know I was there. You heard me. All right, so I think we've talked that just about the death. So what's been going on at the national level? Because I've been buried in local for days.
I don't know. Honestly, things have been kind of dead, believe it or not.
I don't know, because I started hearing all this thing about reverse racism.
I don't have her name up in front of me, but this new editor, she's like a science and tech editor that the New York Times hired, that, I mean, in a nutshell, she literally just thinks that all white people should be dead for the most part. I mean, that's what it boils down to.
Kill the Kraken.
And right. But, you know, NYT defends it and says, well, she's not a racist. She's, you know, you need to look at the context and what she's saying and whatever.
All hunkies must die. Oh, wait, sorry.
Yeah. Yeah. But there was, you sent it to me right after I had just seen it. Was the headline for what publication was it? Let me look this up real quick.
I'm gonna say I don't have it pulled up. Otherwise, I would have.
I can pull it up here pretty quick, I think. But I was laughing my head off. Come on, I know it was right there. My phone is being slow.
Well, unfortunately, there's been like 4 million messages since the last room I dropped that in, so it's taking me a second to find it. Too many people talking in that room.
Yeah, so James Woods tweets out, headline of the year, and it's the American Conservative, and the headline is, Times hires Harvard-educated honky hater.
I don't know. I'm tired of the hate on all sides, to be honest. That was one of the, you know, that was actually what was kind of refreshing about talking about local politics for 3 days. I got to put aside some of the BS that gets conflated so badly at the national level. I mean, it's still here at the local level, and it's worse than it's ever been. But it's not in the spotlight when you actually start taking apart the things that are going on in my state and actually looking at them without having that lens flare of hate. I've actually really enjoyed that because I'm just over it. We're not accomplishing anything anymore other than driving people further apart from each other, all because we can't even have a decent civil conversation just because somebody disagrees with them. That's like I heard about another story today that a friend told me when I got to the day job, and he was like, so this is a pretty interesting story, and I can't even remember the dude's name, but apparently he's big into gaming, and he was at like one of the biggest gaming conventions of the year, and he's like majorly conservative, and it basically online managed to irritate a bunch of left-leaning people, so he was actually interviewing a Nazi for his blog. His video blog that he does, and somebody came up behind him while he was interviewing the Nazi, tapped him on the shoulder and said, hey, are you such and such? And he said, why, yes, I am. Dude knocked him out, jumped on top of him MMA style and just started pounding him and then took off running. They finally figured out who he is. Now they've got an arrest warrant out for him. But this has got to stop. You're beating the crap out of somebody because they support a president. That's got to stop. We didn't do that with Obama supporters. No matter how much they said that's what we were trying to do, we didn't do that. We did some crazy crap. I saw the racist posters and the burning him in effigy, but it's not like that hasn't happened before. We've never had anything like this, where people are being abused in the streets for wearing a hat that says Make America Great Again. Do I agree with the slogan? No. It's the same thing that I said Wednesday morning on KOKC Radio. We don't need to say Make America Great Again. America's never stopped being great. We just need to actually remember that we are first Americans, at least those of us that came here legally, and I know that's going to piss some of you off, but I don't care. If we focused on the people that are here, that came here legally, and actually put all of us first, things would be a hell of a lot better for everybody. I don't care what your skin color is. I care whether or not you're supposed to be here. That's what I care about. If you came here illegally, get the hell out. Otherwise, I'm happy to have you. I don't care how you got here, as long as you did so legally, and I don't care what color you are, as long as you got here legally, and as long as you were a citizen. I don't care. What I care about is all of this now that because I know where it's coming from, because they've already projected that based on the fact that we're now aborting more children than we're creating, thank you, Democrats, we're about to be the minority within about the next 20 to 25 years. So people are figuring that out. That's why there's all of a sudden there's this whole, we hate the honkies and we want to kill all the white peoples and the crackers must die, because they're figuring out that soon enough we're going to be a minority. And they're going to feel like, they're going to be like, we're going to finally get to treat you the way your ancestors treated us. I didn't have a damn thing to do with how your ancestors got treated. So why the hell are you so pissed off at me?
Well, yeah. And, I want to, here's a something that I found. I don't even know if I want to say interesting. There's a gentleman, I kind of follow him on Twitter, but more friends with him on Facebook. And on Facebook, he tends to put out some stuff that gets some good conversation going. It's a gentleman named Kevin Boyd, and he posted this yesterday. He said, "One argument I wish conservatives and Republicans would quit making is the Dems are the real racists. It's just stupid." I don't necessarily disagree with him, but I mean, what I said to that was, I agree to an extent. I said my only problem is that they consistently use the races. I don't like the word racist. I've been called it enough. What they are is race opportunists. Well, this gentleman replies to me. He says, "Yes, between that comment and the last election, it's clear most Republicans have no problem with racism. They just don't like the word racism." So I came back to him and I said, and it was hard to tell for sure if it was aimed at me, but I said, "Was this aimed at my comment? If so, A, I'm not a Republican. B, I didn't vote for Trump. C, I'm called a racist all the time. The word means nothing to me. And D, your projection is noted." And he came back with, "I wouldn't say most Republicans are racist, but given who they elected, they have to at least be okay with it." Now, where I go with this is, I don't understand where the whole Trump is a racist thing comes from. I mean, he's never really said anything racist, as opposed to Hillary. He's never really done anything racist. It's Mexico isn't a race. So, you know, the whole, even though I don't think it's that he dislikes Mexicans, I think that's that he wants to control our border. Where does this come from, that Trump is a racist and that everybody that voted for him is okay with racism? Where does this come from?
I have no idea, because it's kind of hard for somebody that's actually gotten awards from the NAACP to be considered a racist.
Exactly. And I've heard some of the things Hillary has said, and they all dismiss that like it means nothing. I really just don't understand this. I mean, this guy, this guy, for what I said, did not, to me, justify what he said to me. And his projection is just insane. I mean, he obviously doesn't know me. Kevin does. Kevin knows that I'm not a Republican. You know, and Kevin and I don't always see eye to eye, but he's one of those guys that we've become, you know, we interact a lot on Facebook because I enjoy his posts, whether I agree with him or not. And he can, you know, he's kind of a middle of the road guy. He's definitely not a Trump fan, though he doesn't hate Trump like the resistance does. You know, and we go back and forth, but some of these people that jump in, I mean, he gets some real serious trolls, you know, and this guy wasn't, but it went on from there, and it kept going, like he was trying to make me look like I'm some kind of, you know, like diehard Trump supporter, which I'm trying to explain to him. I'm not. I didn't vote for him. You know, I told him who I voted for. I told him why I voted for who I voted for. And it kept coming back where I must be some kind of racist because I will in any way whatsoever support anything Trump does. Yeah, how does that make me a racist? I don't understand that.
Well, I mean, it's not like you support everything Trump does either. All right, folks, we have hit the bottom of the hour. We've been really bad about this lately, so we should probably take some breaks. We'll be right back. This is the Robinson and Wright Show right here on KLRNradio.com. And we hope you guys are enjoying the rest of your Friday night. Back before you know it. Everyone loves the government. So why are you letting other people tell you what's best for your healthcare? Exercise your freedom with Liberty HealthShare. Liberty HealthShare is a community of people who voluntarily share one another's medical costs. Liberty HealthShare is founded on the idea that most people truly want to help one another. Healthcare sharing allows members to do just that as a true community that supports one another in times of need. Liberty believes people should make decisions for themselves and their families. Members are able to take back the freedom to make their own decisions about their healthcare. Freedom from guilt or doubt about how your money is used. You have the freedom to direct your health care, not to be dictated to by bureaucrats. Stop letting others tell you what to do and join a community of like-minded people. Exercise your freedom. Join Liberty HealthShare and take back the control of your health care while helping those around you. Call Liberty at 855-58-LIBERTY. Again, that's 855-58-LIBERTY for more information, or you can check them out at libertyhealthshare.org. Again, that's libertyhealthshare.org.
My son was in the Army back during Desert Storm. But even then, he wanted an MBA. He looked at a dozen schools, but only one offered the online education and flexibility he needed while he was in a tent in Iraq. Grantham University. Turns out that Grantham's been delivering affordable, relevant college and advanced degrees for over 65 years. Heck, if they can deliver a quality education to a soldier in a tent overseas, think about the flexibility Grantham can offer you so you can earn your degree too. It doesn't matter how complicated or full your life is, if getting a degree is on your bucket list, you'll want to do what my son did. You'll want to call Grantham. Find out how easy it is to get started on your education so you can check that college degree off your bucket list. Call Grantham right now. 800-910-1370. That's 800-910-1370. Flexible, affordable, relevant. Call 800-910-1370.
Tired of paying outrageous prices for Viagra? Well, we have great news for you. Now you can finally get Viagra at huge discounts. Healthy Man allows you to save up to $500 on Viagra. Why pay U.S. pharmacy prices of $15 per pill or more when you can get Viagra for less than $3 a pill? Call today and get 40 Viagra pills for only $99. This can cost as much as $600 at your local pharmacy. You can't afford not to call us. If you want Viagra at the lowest prices, never pay $15 $3 a pill pharmacy prices again. Get Viagra for less than $3 a pill. Call 1-800-516-7602 today and save up to $500 and get 40 pills for just $99. Healthy Man is fast, easy, and affordable. Operators are waiting at 1-800-516-7602 to take your call right now. Call 1-800-516-7602. That's 1-800-516-7602. Again, 1-800-516-7602.
Attention business owners and independent contractors. This is a money-saving message from Tax Mediation Services. If your business owes $20,000 or more in taxes, we can help you today, right now. Listen, dealing with the IRS is no picnic. It's an intimidating and extremely stressful process, and you don't want to go it alone. Our attorneys know every law, every tax break, and every possible opportunity to help you resolve and reduce your tax debt. And if you owe more than $20,000, you may be at the top of their hit list. So don't take your tax debt lightly, because it will not go away on its own. The IRS can seize your bank accounts, your home, and even shut down your business. Call our tax experts today at 1-800-783-0810 and let us deal with the IRS while you focus on your business. That's 1-800-783-0810. Again, that's 800-783-0810.
Hey, before I forget, in case you're listening, I want to give a shout out to the producer that I've had for the last 3 days, Mr. Brad Reed. You made things amazing. By the way, if you're listening, this would make a great morning bumper in case we ever work together again.
Just saying.
Back to the program. So when we left, we were talking about you being a racist because you're basically at least attempting to support the president and the things that you actually agree with that he's doing. Because, I mean, it's not like you agree with everything that he says and does. Just like me, I don't agree with everything that he says and does. But I have to admit, it's getting harder and harder to find things that I don't like. Because, I mean, even like last week, you were talking about the tariffs. I'm not even so sure I disagree with those at this point. Because he's actually starting to get people to come back to the table, which was the whole plan in the first place.
He is. I'm still a little bit afraid that it's going to hurt the automakers and stuff like that. But I'm not, I think he's getting some results out of it, which may definitely make it worth it. You know, I'm still hedging my bet. I mean, it's not my favorite decision of his. I'll put it that way.
It's not mine either. But I don't mean to cut you off. But there was a point that you'd brought up that I kind of want to get to, because I just had a bit of an epiphany about a news story that I heard this morning when I was getting ready to go into the station. Because there was a news story that everybody's up in arms because the administration is trying to roll back some of the mileage restrictions that Obama had placed through the EPA. So it just clicked. I think I know what he's doing. He's trying to roll back these other things that were making car manufacturing more expensive to help offset the costs that may come in from the tariffs.
Yeah, I saw that story too, and I think that may definitely be what he's trying to do. And like I said, I think we are seeing some results from it. I think there are some countries that are kind of like, okay, we definitely need to start negotiating this stuff again, which is good, because I mean we've been getting screwed.
Well, but I mean, let's be honest, we've been in a trade war since the 50s. We were just too afraid to fire a shot,
right? You know, sometimes I just think he needs to slow down a little bit. But so far it's, you know, it's like our friend Ordy said, he's kind of like, you know, Frank Drebin from Police Squad. You know, it looks like a disaster and somehow he walks backwards and falls off the steps and stands up and everything's perfect and everything works out. I, you know, And I'll take that. Believe me, I'll take that.
I'll take that over the last 8 years for sure.
Absolutely. But yeah, and you know, we came back kind of after leaving on that thing. And the funny thing about that guy, that he wasn't really calling me a racist. He's just saying that I'm okay with it. Which is kind of a new twist on that. Oh, I don't necessarily think you're a racist. I just think you're okay with it. Well, doesn't that kind of make me a racist if I'm okay with it?
Yeah, but that's the thing. How is support, and again, this goes back to the conversation that we had a couple of weeks ago. The guy that was best man at my wedding unfriended me on Facebook, basically because I was being a tongue-in-cheek smartass, because he put out this post and said, "For all you Trump-supporting Nazi bastards, stop trying to send me a friend request because I'm not going to accept." And I said, "So what happens if we're already supporting the president?" Because I didn't vote for him, but I got to tell you, I'm kind of supporting a lot of the stuff that he's doing now. Dude unfriended me over it. Known the dude for years. In real life, we used to work together. He was my best man at my wedding. He unfriended me over a freaking president. I mean, this is the thing that drives me insane. For all of you that are praying, that you're hoping that he fails, that you just want him to crash and burn, you're hoping that he takes the rest of us with him. Because that's what will happen if he fails. It's the same thing that we saw under Obama. He failed in so many ways for the things that he was trying to do, or at least the things that he was pretending he was trying to do. He failed miserably. And we saw the results of that over and over and over again. And now we have somebody that's at least trying to fix this mess. We can't fix it right away. It's not going to be able to be fixed overnight. I mean, look. Looking at everything this man has done for the last nearly 2 years, I have one question. Were the last three presidents even trying?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, it was like, I can use this as an example. When we found out that, you know, the whole Obamacare thing was going to happen and it was being written up, and we knew it was going to get pushed through. I wasn't sitting there going, I hope this fails. I hope this is the worst thing ever. And I hope it's a disaster and it screws up everybody's health insurance. I wasn't doing that. I was going, well, when this comes out, I hope it's a great plan and I hope it works out. And I hope that it makes it so that everybody can get affordable insurance, and maybe my insurance will go down and my insurance will be better.
Yeah.
Which my insurance wasn't bad. My insurance was actually pretty good.
I had really good insurance.
And what it did was it made my insurance really bad.
But
I wasn't hoping that was going to happen.
If you like your doctor, you can keep your doctor. If you like your plan, you can keep your plan. Oh, I'm sorry. I was only kidding. Not to mention, remember, it was supposed to save us $2,500 a year annually. You know how much that thing cost me? We've talked about it. We've talked about it before. I completely lost one of my insurance plans to the point now where and again, I'm not saying this is going to happen, but one of the things that I've been kind of mulling over is, should I get an offer from the station that I just did a sit-in for the last few days? It will probably be as a contractor. So now, which is good, it's not good to a point, but at the same time, it kind of is, because before, you know, if they were paying well enough, I could have just, you know, taken that gig as a contractor and been on my wife's insurance and not had to worry about anything. But now I don't have insurance through my wife, which means now I have to, at least if nothing else, go part-time plus, which is what they call it at the job I have now, so that way I can work a shorter schedule over there but still keep access to my benefits, which is going to be good in the short term because it means I can get, if this all happens, and I'm not saying it's going to, but if it does happen, then I can start putting the money from the what was the full-time job that's now going to be the second job towards catching things up, paying things off. But at some point, if I could get things squared away, I'd really like to be able to just do this stuff all the time, either for them or for us. But somewhere, somehow, some way, I'm going to have to find a way to get insurance because I'm old. I got to have the shit now.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, it used to be if you had to get it on your own, you could get into a pool or something like that. But now most of the pools even, the rates are so high you can't afford it. And the deductibles are huge. And it's ridiculous. And God forbid you actually make decent money and you want to get Obamacare. Because if you want to get Obamacare, it's going to cost you an arm and a leg.
And maybe a torso.
Yeah, I mean, you know, before Obamacare, my employer paid 100% of my premium, and I had zero deductible, $20 copays on doctor's visits, $10 copays on prescriptions, and a $50 copay for emergency room visits. And everything else was covered. I mean, I think I had a $250 copay for major. You know, if I had to have surgery, it cost me $250. Now I have $12,500 deductible. I am back to copays for doctor's visits. It's $35, but everything else is astronomical. If I have to go to the emergency room, it costs me $500. Luckily, usually when I get hurt, it's at work, so I don't have to worry about it. But I just, it destroyed my health care. Oh, and by the way, I'm paying, what, almost $200 a week in premiums. Whereas before Obamacare, I paid zero. And they say, well, what's your employer's fault? No, it's not my employer's fault. When the premiums skyrocket, he can't afford to pay them anymore. You know, we had a pretty serious meeting a couple years into Obamacare. We had a pretty serious meeting, the whole company. And, I mean, he put it up to us. You know, do this is what the plan's going to be, and this is what it's going to cost you. And, you know, do we want to do this, or do we want to drop back? And I mean, he literally said, and I pay the fines. And you all go out and try to get Obamacare or get your own insurance, because it was cheaper for him to pay the fines for not offering us health insurance than it was for him to cover us.
Yeah. And that's the really sad part about all this. I mean, that's like, you know, before Obamacare, I didn't have copays because I had double coverage. I didn't. I could walk in. Half the time, I honestly think I was getting scammed because they realized I had two forms of insurance. I'd go into the doctor for a hangnail. They wanted to run 4 million tests because I had two forms of insurance. I didn't care because I wasn't paying for it. I didn't have to come out of pocket anything. One insurance covered one thing. Anything that was left over, the other insurance policy picked it up. It was nice because I could actually afford to go to the doctor and I didn't have to come out of pocket anything. Now, anytime I go to the doctor, I have to come out of pocket at least a copay, sometimes even more.
Yeah, and I mean, I didn't mind my copays because I didn't have any premiums to pay. I mean, you know, me or one of the kids had to go to the doctor. It cost $20. I was fine with that. I was totally fine with that. You know, I ended up with, you know, I mean, it killed me after everything changed when Blue Cross Blue Shield changed, you know, our policy, and I went to it was $12,500 deductible. I mean, the first year, my son had appendicitis, had to have his appendix out. Boom, I owed $12,500.
Ouch.
I mean. Yeah, and I'm still was paying, you know, it's dropped. I mean, but I was paying somewhere between $200 and $300 a week out of pocket for my premiums.
That's a lot of money.
But that was my $2,500 a year savings.
That's a lot of money.
Yeah.
So, you know, other little funny thing about being in a studio today for the last few days, I always used to freak out because my chair is really squeaky in my home studio. I realized the chairs at the radio station studio do the same thing, so I'm kind of not nearly as freaked out about hearing your chair squeak as I used to be. I was like, eh, if it's good enough for them, it's good enough for me. What the hell do I care? But yeah, it was funny because one of the chairs is really, really loud, and Dave's trying to move a little bit today, and it was like, and he's like, oh my God. I'm like, yeah, you got to be careful. It was funny.
Yeah, but, I would like to have video of that show today.
Yeah, actually.
You and Dave.
I was thinking about trying to figure out how to get Facebook Live going, and we got in there and started talking and BSing, and I completely forgot about it. I was going to, because I know that they have a setup that you have to use like your own phone and stuff, but they have a setup that will actually kind of do what our voice meter program does and route all this stuff from like the calls and stuff back through Facebook Live, so it actually works just like it's actually a video streaming show is basically what will happen. I don't think Brad knew enough about that, and I didn't think to ask him because he's only been there. He's been there for a few days, but he officially took over Wednesday, about halfway through the show, and then the guy that was the morning producer came out and actually got in front of the mic with me for a bit, which was kind of fun. he was always the liberal lackey for the old programming director, even though he's not nearly as liberal as he pretended to be. Although he is and was a Bernie bro, but yet calls himself a moderate. I was like, dude, you can't have voted for Bernie Sanders and consider yourself moderate.
You can't be a moderate and vote for a socialist.
Yeah, that's not how that works. But yeah, so I'm not sure what he's doing, or I think he's still affiliated with the station, but I think he's only doing like part time work or something, like if they need like remote help or something. Thing, but I don't know. He was pretty tight-lipped about where he was going afterwards, so I didn't really ask. But I don't know. It was an interesting experience. I thoroughly enjoyed it. And if they ask me back again, as long as I don't get in trouble with the day job, I'll come back in as often as they need me to. And if they ever ask to start paying me, I'm probably going to break down and start crying like a girl. Not even going to lie about it. Because the one thing that the last 3 days have taught me is this is exactly what I want to do.
Yeah, well, I can't see them, if they need somebody, not trying to get you to fill in here and there if you're getting the reviews that you're getting. I mean, but I would love to see this just be your full-time gig.
From your lips to God's ears, sir.
I mean, I've known you for how long now? I mean, I've known you for longer than we've done radio together. I mean, in a sense, at least on social media. And, I mean, I know it's just all you've ever wanted to do.
Yeah, you know, I was actually talking about that. We were talking about it for a second, and then she shot me an email where I got to fill in a bunch of blanks about stuff that I wanted to put on the website profile. Speaking of which, you will probably get one of those soon, so be prepared. Because there's like this new feature that allows them to do different links of bios for different parts of the website, so they're trying to get them all put together. But so we were talking about it before she sent me the email, and I was talking about, and I'd forgotten about it honestly until she asked me. I was probably 10 or 11 years old, and I actually thought of an even younger time before that, but this was the one that kind of stuck in my head when she asked me, and then she sent me an email and. With this, the questions on it, and had me write it out so she had it for the stuff. But so I was probably 10 or 11 years old. It was in the summer. My cousin and I would spend hours with a little dual tape deck, you know, the one that would let you play a song and then you could actually record into another deck.
Mm-hmm.
So that had a microphone built into it, so it could actually pick up stuff that was said or whatever in the room. So what we would do for hours is pretend we were hosting a morning radio show. And what I did one year for my dad's birthday is we mixed a tape together with a lot of his favorite songs with us pretending that we were the DJs coming in and out of break. It's always been something that I wanted to do. And then I even thought of something even earlier than that when I was filling in the email that she sent me. And I was thinking back when I was in third grade, which had to be, probably 7, 8 years old. There was like 3 weeks once during the school year that me and a group of friends were actually, we were asking to stay in at recess because we were sitting with the old school black tape deck. You know, the one that like the ones the psychiatrists and stuff used to use, like the old school ancient ones. And mm-hmm. we were pretending we were the chipmunks recording stuff while we were on recess. That's how long that radio has been a part of what I wanted to do. And in some ways, I'd even forgotten about how much I wanted to do it. The last 3 days have completely woke that back up in me. So somehow, some way, even if it's that I keep doing the stuff that I'm doing right here, I'm going to keep doing this one way or the other because it's what I feel like I'm supposed to do. Whether I do it here or there or both, that's not up to me. That's up to God.
Yeah.
I just know I'm supposed to do it.
It's, you know, it's kind of like with me, you know, I never really had a desire to actually do radio until, you know, we really thank a mutual friend of ours, Hammy, who kept hounding me and hounding me and hounding me to do his show. And then finally I did. And when I did, I mean, he finally talks me into it. And the first thing he does, he had a panel on. He had three of us on there. And the first thing he does is go to me. And I was like, oh, really, Hammy? But I loved it. By the end of the hour, I loved it. And that's when I started really wanting to do it. But ever since I was a little kid, I mean, 5, 6 years old, I mean, I used to go to sleep at night listening to WLS in Chicago. I just always loved radio. You know, I mean, even when we had cassettes. I mean, it got to the point where I was listening to some music that just wasn't available on the radio, but I would always go to the radio in the car before putting in a cassette or a CD, just because there was something about radio. There's something, I don't know. It's almost like there's something, I don't know, something about it. I don't know. I mean, you and I, kind of point I'm making, you and I both have a love for it, and it was a different kind of love up until here recently. I enjoyed doing it now. I never had a desire until Hammy talked me into doing his show. I never had a desire to be on the air.
And now here you are. I want to get to a couple of things because I've been remiss. We've got Ron hanging out in the chat. So he wanted to get, well, actually this was from a few minutes ago, but when you said that you were concerned because you felt like Trump was doing things a little too quickly, Ron actually had a pretty good response to that. He says he's doing things fast because he knows he might only have one term. And then as to why the left is being so crazy about everything, we're catching hell because of Limbaugh's I hope he fails, and McConnell's my job is to make sure he only serves one term, in my honest opinion. They remember that crap and are feeding it back to us. He's probably got a point.
He's got a point. He definitely got a point with the possibility of one term, though. The way things are going right now and with the way the left keeps shrieking, I would not be surprised at all for Trump to be a two-term president.
I wouldn't be surprised at all either unless they can finally get some traction on this crap that they've been trying to throw at him, and I just don't see any way to do it. Actually, one thing, and then we probably need to start wrapping up, because there was one thing that I couldn't really talk about over there. I wanted to, but I tried to keep things as local as possible. Actually, I take that back. Brad brought it up, so we did get a chance to talk about it. So Facebook got in trouble again, or factually they said they found 36 accounts they feel were linked to Russian bot farms, troll farms, whatever, recently. First of all, out of how many millions of accounts, they found 36. Second of all, funny thing about these 36 accounts, they all had resisty-sounding names. Eyes confuzzled.
Imagine that.
Just a little confuzzled. Just a little. I thought the Russians were trying to help Trump. See, actually, that was probably one of the favorite segments I had with Brad, because we just started talking about it, because he feels the same way I did, because I honestly thought when we found out that, because we knew that Russia was using social media to try to influence the election by pissing off both sides, we really thought this was going to be the virtual 9/11, where everybody was going to be like, holy shit, the Russians are messing with us. We need to come together and make sure this doesn't happen again. And instead, it's all been about Trump. You know, we both had the same reaction. We figured when the truth came out and we knew Russia was doing the same thing to us that we've been doing to everybody else for so many years, that everybody was okay with when we were doing it, which is why I can't get mad that they are doing it, because it ain't like we ain't done it. But at the same time, when the truth came out and said, well, this is what we know. Russia was playing both ends against the middle using social media. That should have done something. That should have made something click, and it didn't. And it's disturbing to me that it didn't.
Yeah.
That right there basically just proves it. Because the first batch that they conveniently released months ago when everybody was pissed off about it were all Trumpy group-sounding names. Now, months and months later, after all the brouhaha has kind of died down about it, nobody's really paying attention to it anymore. Oh, by the way, we found these 36 accounts too, and these all sound resisty. That's convenient.
Yeah. I just... I really don't buy into that any of it affected the election in one way or another at all. I just don't buy it. I never will. How long has this investigation been going on?
Don't get me wrong. I'm not necessarily saying at all that I think it impacted the election. But what I am saying is we now know, because we've seen proof, that they've been trying to play both ends against the middle in regards to the election and pretty much everything else you could possibly think of, because Barack Obama was a butthead who went around and told everybody how sorry he was for how mean we were. And Russia went, oh, look, we have a pansy in the White House now. Let's see how much of the world we can change while he's not paying attention.
Well, yeah, I mean, Obama just, I mean, his all the way around, it wasn't even just with, it was with everybody, and all the way around, his foreign policy was a disaster. It was a disaster. He did more to lower our guard and lower our defenses to outside influence than anybody in history.
Yeah.
But my Trump Russia, whatever. Yeah,
but Trump's the bad guy. All right, brother, yeah. I don't mean to cut you off, but we're back around to the bottom of the hour, and or top of the hour, and at this point, I've been up for 20 hours. I'm going to bed.
Yeah, and I got to work tomorrow. Dang it.
All right, so on that note, folks, we are going to get out of here. It was great being back home on KLRNradio.com. Not saying if they ask, I won't go back to KOKC, but it's been great being home. Hope everybody enjoys the rest of your Friday night. Got a good weekend coming up. We'll see you guys. I'll be back regular schedule, as far as I know, on Monday, because I have to let some time build up again before I can fill in. So I will see you guys back here Monday night. We'll be back. See you then. Take care.